today in my session, what I'm going to describe, what I'm going to talk about is about how to build a developer program in the context of a large corporation and already from the ground up, so meaning starting from the scratch. No, it's not an easy topic, and it's something that I have had the opportunity to do in the last years together with my team, and there were a lot of things that I learned, and for me it's a pleasure to be able to share those learnings with you today. So let's get into it. I think that the presentation will be interesting not only for the ones who may have to go through that equivalent very soon, but also for the ones who may be going now through that in the middle of it, and also for the ones that may have done it and may be able to refer and compare versus what I'm going to share with you today. So who hasn't started, or if not, who will not face this kind of excuses or statements when they have to launch an API program in a large corporation? No, it's very common to listen to this kind of excuses, like we don't have the right budget for that, that's not a priority, we have other things to do. It's very difficult to start a program when you find this kind of excuses. No, so the topic today will be, how can we overcome many of the resistances that we are going to encounter, no, in this kind of context and environment? So I will start by sharing only 30 seconds about the company in which I work for and the industry. And the reason is because I'm going to refer to many examples about it so that you need to understand a little bit the context. So I work for Amadeus. I am the head of Open Innovation Programs at Amadeus. Amadeus is an IT company that works in the travel industry. We are in the middle, in the sweet spot between all the travel providers and all the travel subscribers, so meaning that we connect to airlines, hotels, car rentals, etc., and we distribute their content. We provide the technology to travel agencies around the world. We also provide technology for their reservation and inventory systems of the airlines, hospitality, etc. So we are a big player. Last year, we processed almost 2 billion of passengers of airlines, more than 600 reservations. So as you can see, it's quite a big company within the travel industry. All right. And within this big industry that we are a big player, we managed to launch a couple of years ago a new open innovation program, which is Amadeus for Developers, in which our intention is to help the innovators and the developers to build the future of travel. All right, so we will build a new program that I'm going to describe how we made it and how we made it accessible today and why it is being a success and how it is easy accessible in a matter of minutes and why there are many good things ongoing. All right, so now that we know the context about the industry in which I'm going to give the examples and how everything started for us in the journey, so these are the areas that I would like to cover today. Number one is, how can you overcome competing priorities with other projects that your organization may be going through? All right, all big organizations have many things ongoing. So how do you make your API program stand out of the others? All right. The second one is about, how can you navigate some advices about how to navigate some corporate culture and structures that you may encounter? What things can you do to be able to make it easier? All right. The third one is about some recommendations about how to address technology. It's a big topic when you are launching a program. So what are the things that we learned and what would be our advice for that? The fourth one is about managing risk, both excuse me, both real and perceived, which are very different. And the fifth one is, once you launch, don't think that everything is done, because actually it will be just the beginning of another phase of the journey. And how can you survive what would be the first baby steps of the new launch program? So if you are interested, let's go for it and let's go through all these five blocks together. All right, so let's say that you have to overcome which are the competing priorities, all right, other programs that may be ongoing. No? So what do we recommend for this situation, especially when you start from the scratch? No? In my case, when I started, literally what I had was a blank page, a blank PowerPoint, and I had to define pretty much everything with my team. So we started by something that sounds logical and simple, but in the end is where I'm going to dedicate most of the time because it's the most important, which is, how do you communicate the value and how can you make your program shine, no, across all the others? No? So there are many projects out there. Why would your top management decide that your program is one of the top priorities among all the others? How do you make it stand out? Right? All right. So they will tell you things like, there is no budget, that is very uncertain, that there are many risks, that maybe the solution or the value that your program may bring to you is not going to be in the very, very short term, which is the top priority focus. So you have to build a value proposition that explains how to address all these areas and more, thinking more into the long term. So the recommendation here is to build a compelling case, and I'm going to share with you how we did it successfully and other ideas that we got from other cases. And be careful, because I'm being very, very exactly the words. I'm not saying to build a compelling business case. I'm saying to build a compelling value-based case. All right, it's a bit different. I don't think that we should focus already from starting to purely the financials of the return of the investments, because the value can come from many different ways. Some of them very easily manageable from the financial point of view, and others through different aspects. All right. So, first of all, our advice is that you build something that provides the context of what does it mean to bring an API program into the organization. And here, one of the best advices is to put it into the framework of the digital transformation, especially now that we are going through a specific tough times with after the COVID or during the COVID pandemic, and most of the companies have to reinvent or at least adapt to new processes and new requirements, right? The second one is clearly state which is the value of the APIs, of the API program that you're going to set up, both in revenues and beyond. And in the next slide, you will see which are those pockets of value that will make it stand out. And the third advice is also highlight the risk of not taking any action. This is very important because sometimes not doing anything can represent a lot of risk or loss of opportunity. No? So also use that into your advantage for that. So let's get into some of them, some ideas. So first of all, always pitch the APIs whenever you can as something that can enable the change. And here one of the beauty for me of the APIs is the fact that they can allow almost any kind of change. APIs, by definition, they are agile, they are scalable, they can be used for almost anything that the developers can think of or the innovators. So this is the kind of thing that can make the organization change. And change is something that has to be there for organizations, whether you like it or not. Actually, if you don't change, it's when you are really in serious trouble. All right? So explain why the APIs change, produce, enable the change, and what are the benefits that they can bring through that change. There are some interesting quotes, for example, this one from Simon Sinek. So the ones that implement the change are the ones that will come stronger and reinvent. And actually, it's interesting, some of the figures that we got from other sources like Harvard, actually from the last three big crises, now that we are in the middle of one, 10% of the top companies managed to reinvent themselves and thrive through change. So that top 10% were not the ones who cost cut and who didn't think into the long-term future and strategy. They were the ones who knew what they had to do to change and to adapt. And APIs are precisely that, right? So focus into what are the enablers of this type of products and technologies. No? On top of that, if you want to bring into the revenue space, which I'm sure that you will be asked, you can cover the part of the revenue, which is on average in the top leading IT companies, 30% of the revenues are brought either directly by APIs or indirectly by APIs. This is another solid statement that you can bring. So if well done, they can bring a lot of significant revenue. And what about beyond revenue? Because it's very important to highlight not only that and not to focus only into the business case. So there are a whole lake of other pockets of opportunity that have to be highlighted, because they are probably, in most cases, even more important than the purely direct revenue that you will get in the short term. So things like the ones that we have written there in the slides, like the possibility to reach new customers of your existing products, the things that are creating new partnerships, or to be able to unlock new ideas, new products, or new business models, right? All that list have specific values for the products. The idea is that you can identify the ones that can be more valuable for your specific company or industry and context, and use those ones to the stakeholders that may be more interested into that. So if you think that the efficiency and automation part will be most interesting for your IT director, for example, raise it to them. And if you think that another one of the innovation head or the strategic growth units are interested in the innovation, explain to them how the APIs can enable that. So look at that, those pockets of opportunities, and translate how the APIs can help us to increase the value in those areas. All right. Lastly, for this first topic, we also found very useful the possibility to create a sense of urgency, meaning that it's not okay to wait for developing API programs because it may be too late. Like I said before, if you don't do anything, that is already taking a decision. So not doing anything is already deciding not to take an action. And there, you can highlight what will be the consequences of not doing that program. For example, you can take the information coming from the customers, the ones that may be demanding more agility to connect to you or to develop new solutions or to do new things that you don't offer today, but they are looking forward to get that previous level of functionalities to develop things on top of your solutions or on top of their solutions as well. So if the customers are demanding that, and usually they do, why not taking that information and showing it to your management? The same goes for competitive. In our case, in Amadeus, we are honest about it. We were not the first ones to create an open API program. And we used the information from the competition to explain to them what was out there in the market, what we thought was happening, what were the benefits that they were getting, and how we thought that not only we should be able to do the same, but even more, even better. In this case, we thought about not being the first ones as an advantage in the sense of checking first what they have done, look at the things that we could do better, and then come out to the market with something that would exceed our competitors. So it's true that we didn't have the first mover's advantage, but if that happens, it's not the end of the world. Let's try to come back stronger by addressing what is out there in the market, in your industry, and then leveraging on those opportunities. So that was the first point about the value of the programs. It's probably the most important, again, because if they don't understand it, they don't see it, they will not give you the green light to move on to the next phases, no? To start to develop the program. So what will happen if you already get the approval for developing something like that, no? For launching a program? Well, in this case, you're going to encounter many other barriers, no? Or difficulties, no? And one of them is the corporate culture and the structure that you may find. Usually, large corporations do not have the optimum setup for developing this kind of programs. It's not bad. It's simply that they are not ready because they have never done it before. But it doesn't mean that it is the right one for developing something like that. So how can you propose to adapt or to evolve the teams and the governance required for making that program a success? No? So the landscape that you will find at the beginning is very complex. In our case, it was, in the sense that they were ready for developing many things and for addressing each of the verticals of travel independently. They were literally thousands of APIs around the organization, but they were not prepared to expose them in an open environment in an easy accessible way, no? And mostly because of the setup and the programs. No? So we found actually many scattered initiatives. So again, many units in Amadeus had different individual and private API programs, but none of them were shared and none of them were ready to be exposed outside. Each of them had their own specific ownership, made total sense, and their own resistance to change something, mostly because of the unknown. So I'm going to talk later in another blog about the risk and how to change that initial resistance. And equally important about the technology, what about the legacy systems in which they are falling? No? So these areas can be broken and adapted to be able to accept that there is a need to do it. So here comes the two main recommendations for this blog. The first one is work on a ring-fence API team. So don't fall into the mistake of having a scattered team that works individually into different areas and they are not working independently and solely focused into this new API program. If they do it, you will end up mixing and having problems with the priorities by not having everybody working on the same topic at the same time. It has to be everybody focused and with a ring fence. Don't allow anybody else to mess around with the budget, with the resources, with the focus. It will not fly otherwise. So secure that you ring fence your team to do that. And the second one is you can have your own governance, define it, and do it in an open and transparent way. Why? Because then you will get the buy-in from the stakeholders of the other programs that they will have to help you to make it a reality. Tell them that they're going to have visibility. Tell them that they're going to have a saying into what you're going to do and how they're going to do it. And then you will be able not only to make them part of your potential resistance, but actually one of the supporters of your program. All right? So for the ring fence team, what we did in our case, and it's something that we also recommend, is find people from different units that they are totally committed and mix them so that they can have an overall 360 overview. So whether they are people from strategy, from program management, obviously from product and for technology, and super important, the DevRel team and marketing, no? They are the teams of bringing the solutions to the developers and the innovators, right? So build these multitasking teams and make them work together. That's for the first advice. And for the second one on the governance, I would like to share with you what we did at Amadeus. So we started by having a program coordinated between corporate strategy, which is where we worked at the time, and sharing that governance across all the different units in Amadeus. There was a platform that was built almost from the scratch, leveraging on other modules. I'll come back into the technology a bit later, technology section. But we built a common platform for maintaining and creating a roadmap of all the new APIs. And we had our product managers coming from all the business units that could contribute with them. We had a centralized committee for the data, so that they could analyze from a transversal point of view the different risks, the types of data, which were the ones that were easily, more easily to be exposed, which ones we couldn't be able to make it. So all the data experts, legal people looking, security people looking into how to expose that data. And then finally the design. No? So we were following some common guidelines created by the experts of the API community, right? They are the ones who are going to consume the solution, so they have to tell us how to do it, no? in the optimal way, right? All right, so those were the two first focus. Let's look into the third one, which is actually how to address the question on technology, which is you may encounter that at the beginning, you have several technologies going around the different parts of the programs. How do you encounter them? How do you put them together? So here we have a simple recommendation based on three main pillars. Number one, treat it as a puzzle. So go piece by piece. Don't think about building something that will cover absolutely all the use cases and all the potential evolution in the future. That would take too long. So start by thinking the pieces, and when you have a basic structure, go for it. And the first recommendation here is rely ideally into some of the API management solutions. Why? Because if not, you will have to start to build one, and that is something extremely complicated. And personally, I think that it wouldn't make sense when there are DR players that provide fantastic solutions, and you can just literally take them. They are not expensive at all. You can adjust what are the parts that you need and the parts that you don't need, and rely on that architectural structure to start with your program. All right? In my case, there are many providers out there. You can research by yourself. You can look into some Magic Quadrants, for example, of Gartner. There are many studies. Most of them are very, very good. Some of them are niche, others are generic, others are more thinking forward, more visionaries. You can have APG, MuleSoft. There are many out there. No? So in our case, we chose APG, but for other reasons, it doesn't mean that it's just the only one out there. There are other options, right? So that will allow you to go faster and to rely on some experience and a good architecture. The second one is define how you want to fill that architecture. Define which are the best technologies that you want to expose in your organization. In our case, for example, we decide to base everything into REST JSON APIs. That technology will probably ease a lot the adoption instead of just using SOAP XML or other kind of technologies that may not be so easily adopted. Right? So define how you want to fill up. And the last one is think about it from the start with the scalability in your mind, meaning that don't cover everything. Start with some minimum viable product at the beginning, and then later on with time, you can add other modules to unlock more use cases and more functionalities from the platforms and from the APIs. Number four is about managing risk. So how do you stay ahead with the concerns that the business units and the other stakeholders from the programs may bring to you? No? In most cases, they are real. In others, it's perceived, and all of them are valid, don't get me wrong. If I were one of those stakeholders or owners of other business units, I would have the same concerns. So they are important and they have to be there. But here, the approach that we propose is the following. Is if you hear for things like there is a risk of cannibalization or legal risk, that is very valid. You will have to address them, all right? If there are security concerns like attacks or what about sensitive data, the same. It's impossible to go out with a new program without addressing those ones. Or finally, about the performance. What about how do you accommodate the scalability for large volume? So how do you tackle these areas that we have selected as examples? So first of all, try to manage all the risk from the start. Don't wait, ideally, until they come back to you with the questions. If you already think about it beforehand, or even better, if you get engaged with those stakeholders from the start to tell them, let's work on your risk before they are even a reality or before you can even raise them across other stakeholders so that you can tell me how and what are those risks. We can work together on how to mitigate them or remove them and then already put it in place from the start. That is a key advantage for all these kind of products because they will see you as a partner instead of someone that is trying to bring something unknown, no, into the organization. Be transparent, and then the same advice, this is always useful. Start small, and if there is something that you cannot tackle, leave it for later in a phase approach. Okay? In our case, I mentioned before that we did with Amadeus for Developers, we launched an MVP. We did it a couple of years ago. We started with a small limited set of just 10 APIs. They were GET APIs only, and we even went to very complex APIs and with low risk data. Once we proved that it worked, everybody saw that it was in the right direction, and it was much, much easier to make it from there and to make it more complex. I will explain to you how we evolved the program also in a minute. All right? Fantastic. So the last block, the number five area that I would like to cover is how do you do after you launch the program? You may think that you have done the tough work, but to me it's actually just another phase. It's actually very tricky to control the excitement when you launch, when you start to be able to see the value coming into your organization, but actually the real situation or the real scenario starts there, because you start to have real customers. They have always very high expectations, and you have to deliver the best to your customers and your consumers. So how do you survive not falling into a stagger or into a very simple approach to APIs, thinking that you have done most of the work? And how do you keep up with the phase of bringing more value and to be able to maximize the value that both the users and you can bring to each other? No? So here there are all the three pillars that I would like to share with you. The number one is, from day one, please treat the users as the new kings. Why? Because you have to define everything about your organization, your setup, your DevRel team, your product, etc., into what those users are going to tell you. Actually, they are the whole focus into the users is what is going to give you the real channel and feedback, the real direction about how to go. So I'm now moving from the first one to the second one, no? Which is the real compass is going to be coming from the feedback from the users, and at the same time for how you measure that feedback plus other KPIs. How do you define those KPIs? Well, here the recommendation, and this is also standard from all industries, is that you define a funnel KPI approach. What is a funnel KPI? You may think about the onboarding process into your program as a funnel, right? So many people may find you from different channels. That is already one KPI. Some of them may enter into your portal, may not register because they may not like it. So there is a churn out and they leave, and others may register. So the base that will register will be a bit smaller versus the ones that found your program, no? What about the ones that register? Some of them may start to consume some of their APIs in test and others not. So a smaller reduction. And some of those may move to production and others may develop new things. So it will take time, but think about it as a funnel in which you can track what are the percentages in between one and another. And that will be very useful to understand where the funnel is not working seamless or flawless and where you have to put more resources to improve things like the portal, the product, the explanation of the value, how to move faster to test or to productions, contracts. Ask the users, they will tell you how to do it. So the answers will be coming from them. And the third one is iterate from there. That's fantastic, because now you have a compass. Up until now, you may have been guessing, or you may have been being directed by the experts or by advices from other people that have done it. But your company at the end of the day should be unique in some way, and you should think about elements that will make it stand out from your competitors. So when you start, go for it. In our case, what did we do? After we proved the point at the beginning, we evolved the program. We came up with many more APIs. Now we have more than 25. And we also make them more complex, even including, for example, some artificial intelligence APIs, which are very cool for innovation ideas, no? So the APIs also become more complex, including post capabilities. The platform became more complex with more capabilities. So it was much more complete, no? And therefore we were enhancing the value. All right. So those were the five blocks I wanted to talk to you about today. I wanted to share with you some other ideas that came out in the travel industry thanks to the program. So
yeah, Fran, you have one more minute to
very actually. Good. Very good. So remember the first slide about the values? Well, at the end of the day, we could prove that they end up coming up. So today we are now much more connected to the innovation ecosystem. We could find much more adoption to a lot of our data and functionalities. There was efficiencies in our APIs, in our web services. We have many more new solutions. And another thing that we found very interesting, we are now very, very well connected to new emerging trends. So because the market is there demanding what to do with your data, you may be able to be very fast at detecting what to do with your data and what they are demanding to you. Now, for example, with the COVID situation, we have a very good radar about how the new solutions have been developed to try to tackle the new landscape. All right. So this is the last slide. It's a recap, in case you want to have it, about the key points of the five blocks that I have explained. So I'm not going to cover them again, but remember, so value, team and governance, address the tech puzzle, minimize the risk, whether it is perceived or real, and then take it step by step into the right evolution that it will be demanded. And if you have any problem or any question, please ask the API Days communities, because we are all here to assist you. We are a fantastic group of friends and trying to help each other. So it's always a pleasure to come with you, and I will keep always relying on this community, because it's fantastic. I would like to thank you very much for allowing the opportunity to share these insights with you. I'm very happy to share with you more information or answer any questions.